We're going to be looking at Psalm chapter 2, so please turn your Bibles to Psalm chapter 2. But I got to thinking, I've been kind of tracking some of the news stories over the last few weeks, and actually, probably the last few years, what can I say? But at any rate, just to share a couple that have been populating the news recently, who hasn't heard about North Korea? They're firing missiles, they're threatening the U.S. and other countries, and, you know, in a change of policy that didn't work previously, our president's given it right back. Iran is still making, they're still spewing threats against Israel and the United States, and they're not backing off the nuclear program, and that's a mess. Citizens of countries who were welcomed as Islamic refugees are now targeting citizens in that country and committing acts of terrorism. We have ISIS, we have Al-Qaeda, we have terrorists all over the world. We have citizens, there's all sorts of craziness going on, but you come back home and we have the Democrats hate our president and they hate Republicans, and our Republicans hate them right back. And, you know, we have California lawmakers seem to be so mad at Trump that they're really trying to negate any Trump or federal influence there. And then we have this incredibly smooth, unified atmosphere in our own White House, right? All right, well, maybe not. We have Antifa, we have white supremacists, we have rallies, we have protests, we have riots, some of them right on our college campuses. And we have statues being torn down, and, you know, we have a Supreme Court. Well, actually, we have courts throughout the United States that are pretty much nullifying every restriction about abortion that seems to come along. And we're kind of backing off and wondering just what in the world is going on. Well, actually, it's kind of interesting, but a lot of what's going on is addressed in our psalm today. Let's take a look at it. By the way, I do need to ask, though, as we jump into it, is anyone really listening? I don't think so. Why do the nations rage and the people plot a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against His anointed, saying, "Let us break their bonds in pieces and cast away their cords from us. He who sits in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall hold them in derision. Then he shall speak to them in his wrath and in distress them in his deep displeasure. Yet I have set my king on my holy hill of Zion. I will declare the decree. The Lord has said to me, 'You are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me and I will give you the nations for your inheritance and the ends of the earth for your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron. You shall dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Now therefore be wise, O kings, be instructed, you judges of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry and you perish in the way, when his wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are all those who put their trust in him." You know, Psalm 2 is actually considered a royal psalm in the Old Testament. It may have been written by David. We do not know. There's no authorship listed, but it actually speaks about David in a sense. And more particular, scholars believe it's speaking of his coronation, his becoming the king of Israel. Now, I know this may come as a shock, but you know, there were people in Israel that really weren't jazzed about him becoming king. There were people outside of Israel that weren't jazzed about his becoming a king. Does that sound a little contemporary to you? You know, we have people that aren't jazzed about people becoming leaders all throughout history. But what we really are looking at in these verses is man's rebellion. I'm going to switch over now to the New Living Translation and give you another perspective, use some of the vernacular of our day. But I want you to listen to this. In verse 1 in the New Living Translation, it says, "Why are the nations so angry?" I mean, why is North Korea so angry? What is going on with them? You know, are these people just nuts? Well, it says, "Why do they waste their time with futile plans? You know, when I think about a country like North Korea, I'm like, do you really think you're going to whoop the United States of America? I mean, do you really think that? I mean, there's a part of me that just kind of wonders. This is like nuts. But you know, here's what the Proverbs says in chapter 24. Do not envy wicked men nor desire their company, for their hearts plot violence and their lips talk about making trouble. By wisdom a house is built, and through understanding it is established. Through knowledge, its rooms are filled with rare and beautiful treasures. But what's so fascinating to me is throughout history, and we've seen this. I mean, if you look at a historical perspective, by the way, you know the saying, those who forget history are doomed to repeat it. But all through history, people have plotted. They've been angry. They plotted vain things. They've gone to war with their neighbors. And what have they ended up with? I mean, really, what have they ended up with? Well, they have usually end up with a lot of dead bodies. There's a lot of carnage. There's a lot of suffering. But in verse 2, it says, the kings of the earth prepare for battle. Again, North Korea is rattling its saber. You know, Iran is, they're making threatening noises, particularly towards Israel. But who are they really fighting? Who do they want to fight? Well, the kings of the earth prepare for battle. The rulers plot together against the Lord and against his anointed one. You see, in reality, what they're doing is they're fighting God. They're fighting righteousness. You know, very few kings go to battle for righteous reasons. In World War II, we largely as a nation went to battle. We went to war against Nazi Germany and the Japanese, in essence, because what they did was wrong, but we didn't even do all of that right. But it was, in essence, what we called a righteous war. But that is a rarity. Why did Nazi Germany go to war? Why did Japan go to war? You know, but verse 3 says, let us break their chains, they cry, and free ourselves from slavery to God. Let us free ourselves from slavery to God. Why do people fight? Why do we riot on our college campuses? Why do we mess with the man? You know, we have lots of reasons, and some of them aren't bad. But ultimately, what we find all too often is people are rebelling against God. They don't want to be a slave to God. They don't want to be under his sway. They don't want to be under his control. But don't you realize that you become a slave of whatever you choose to obey? You can be a slave to sin, which leads to death, or you can choose to obey God, which leads to righteous living. Romans 6:16. But Psalms 14 and 53 begin with these words. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. And you know, it's kind of interesting, but before I would go and pick a fight with John over here, I need to ask the question, why would I pick a fight with him? You know, John happens to be a believer. And if I start wailing on him, guess who I'm wailing on? In reality, well, I'm not just wailing on you, brother, but I'm wailing on Jesus. You know, when Saul was going out to persecute Christians, Jesus confronted him on the road to Damascus and said, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Oh, what? Jesus was already in the grave. He had already ascended. He wasn't on earth. But you see, when people mess with us, they're messing with God, which is very interesting. And so, in a real sense, the world doesn't like God. It doesn't like the constraints God puts around us. We want to live life on our own terms and our own way. But then, as Paul also wrote in chapter 8, verse 7 of Romans, he says, "For the sinful nature is always hostile to God. It never did obey God's laws, and it never will." You know, it's also kind of an interesting thing. You know, in America, we get very angry at people who hold views in opposition to us. As followers of Christ, we have a set, kind of a form of morality. We have a lens by which we see the world around us, and sometimes we become very upset. We become upset at those who are pro-abortion or those who are trying to promote a marriage that we find is not acceptable to God. We wrestle with attitudes, and we wrestle with hearts, and we wrestle with what we see as unrighteous. But what's funny about this is we don't always think that that is what lost people do. It really is. If you do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you are a slave, not to Christ, but you're a slave to the other dude. And the reality of it is, as well, is that this is not just a friendly competition between Satan and God. This is all-out war. This is called spiritual warfare. And what we deal with day in and day out is we are watching spiritual warfare being waged on our world, in our communities, and sometimes right even in our own homes, and dare I mention, even in our hearts. We wrestle with all of that. Because even in our own hearts, we don't always want to be a slave to God. We want to live life on our terms. We want to do what we want to do. We do what we do because we want what we want. And we don't always want righteousness. We don't always want to follow Christ. You know, Paul took some time to explain the purpose of the law to Timothy. In 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 9 through 12, he says, "For the law was not intended for people to do what is right." You know, that's an amazing thing. When we think about that, I have people come and say, "Well, you know, how are you doing with the Ten Commandments?" Well, you know, in reality, can I share with you, not so well. If we're very honest, I don't think any of us are doing all that well with the Ten Commandments. But it's not for those who do what is right. It is for people who are lawless and rebellious, who are ungodly and sinful, who consider nothing sacred and defile what is holy, who kill their father or mother or commit other murders. The law is for people who are sexually immoral or who practice homosexuality or are slave traders, liars, promise breakers, or who do anything else that contradicts the wholesome teaching that comes from the glorious good news entrusted to me by our blessed God. And so the world is in opposition. You know, when you turn on a news channel or you hear someone and they're talking about how, you know, about how Darwinian evolution is the truth, it is an enemy who doesn't want you to know the truth. It's at war. You see, the enemy is at war with God, and you are to be his spoils. But what is God's response? Because God does have a response. You know, if you've been following the news, you know that there are those in our country that are blaming everything bad on our president. From the hurricanes, and just recently I heard that a college professor was blaming our president for the shootings in Las Vegas. You know, and they teach our kids. I mean, this is scary. But here's the question. Do they really believe what they're saying? Do they really believe that? Well, you know, as I thought about that, I came across a verse yesterday in my devotion. I want you to listen to this. This is really cool. We'll have it up on the screen. It says, "Just as they have chosen their own ways, and their soul delights in their abominations," which, by the way, is anything contrary to what God's will says, "so will I choose their delusions and bring their fears on them. Because when I called, no one answered. When I spoke, they did not hear. But they did evil before my eyes and chose that in which I do not delight." I love this. This is the New King James. It says, "So I will choose their delusions." You know, we like to, by the way, they also choose their punishment. That's how other translations put it. Their punishment or harsh treatment. You know, what's so fascinating is that people want to believe what they want to believe. People do what they do because they want what they want, so on and so forth. And yet, what's fascinating, we like to say, well, I'm going to be my own man. I'm going to be my own woman. I'm going to think for myself. You know what God's word says? The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord, and he turns it whithersoever he will. You know, Cyrus probably thought when he was setting the Israelites free that it was his big idea. And yet Jeremiah wrote about it decades, maybe even a century before. You know, it's amazing to me when you study the Bible. When you see Nebuchadnezzar coming in and conquering Israel, and you're thinking, wow, you know, that must have been his idea. No, it was actually God's idea. God needed to judge his people. And he used a man named Nebuchadnezzar to do it. And we think that these people, they're just all full of themselves. And in a manner of speaking, they are. But you know, when a person speaks contrary to God and they're determined about it and they're not going to be confused by the truth, can I share with you, it may just be that God has chosen their delusions for them. It may be that God is acting in a form of judgment already on them. Can I share with you, we ought not to be happy about that. That ought to really concern us. That ought to really get us on our knees and pray. Because I wonder how many delusions we have. I wonder how many things we struggle with. But then we also read in Ecclesiastes, because the sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily, therefore the heart of the sons of man is fully set in them to do evil. You know, it is fascinating to me. You know, when you look at wars, and I've been somewhat of an amateur student of military history, but when I look at wars, sometimes the bad guy, let's call him the bad guy, the one who's just, you know, tearing into people like Hitler did, like Germany did in World War I, or whatever. I mean, and many times it looks like they are winning, that they are winning. You know, when you look even at our own Civil War, and you look at the fact that the South stood for slavery, that really, while the common soldier probably was not necessarily fighting for that, that ultimately was one of the primary causes of the Civil War. And you know what's fascinating to me is that for a long time, it looked like we in the North, we who lived up in Pennsylvania and maybe believed that slavery was wrong and believed in the righteousness of our cause, we were getting our butts kicked. There was a guy named Robert E. Lee who was an absolute military genius. So is Stonewall Jackson. By the way, they want to tear their statues down now. Let's forget about history. Let's forget about what happened in the past. But yet, on the battlefield of a place called Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, on a turn of a dime, the whole conflict changed. Now, hundreds of thousands of soldiers would lose their lives. But yet, what's fascinating to me is how God moves. And they think, okay, well, we're winning. Let's keep going. Hey, you know, come on. Let's keep doing this. And so it is with us. We think, well, you know, I can do something that's not honoring God. I can do something that he speaks about in his word, and I know it's wrong, but you know, God hasn't smacked me yet, so maybe it's okay. But it's not okay. And there's coming a day when we're going to know that. There's coming a day when the world who says I can get away with this and that, someday there's going to be a reckoning. But here was God's response. But the one who rules in heaven laughs. The Lord scoffs at them. This is an anthropomorphism because we're trying to put some kind of a human trait on God to understand what God is doing. But I can imagine that God is up in heaven and he's looking at the Democrats and he's looking at the Republicans. He's looking at North Korea. He's looking at Iran. He's looking at the Supreme Court of the United States or whatever entity that's going along mocking God. And he's going, oh, that's funny. They think they got this all figured out. They think they're winning. No. There's coming a day of judgment. There's coming a day of reckoning. It may happen in our life. It may not happen until the end. But it's coming. Again, Psalm 37 says, the wicked plots against the righteous and gnashes his teeth at him, but the Lord laughs at the wicked, for he sees that his day is coming. His day is coming. And then in anger, he rebukes them, terrifying them with his fierce fury. Do you know how many empires and civilizations who turned their back on God have survived to this day? Do you know how many of them? Actually, there's one. And the only reason this one has survived largely intact as a people group is because they figure in Scripture at the end of time. And that nation is Israel. Every other civilization who turned its back on God is no more. People say, well, they're still Egyptians. Not like they were. They're still the Romans. You know, it's kind of interesting, too. You think like the Romans. You know, there was a time when the most fearsome name on earth was the Roman legions. These guys, they were like a mighty military machine that cleaned everyone's clock. And then there was World War II. You know, and the Italians were lousy soldiers for the most part. Civilizations have come, civilizations have gone. When they turn their back on God, God rebukes them. By the way, do we think we're an exception to that here in America? I mean, do we think we're somehow going to escape all of that? Again, it ought to drive us to our knees. And then verse 6 says, for the Lord declares, I have placed my chosen king on the throne in Jerusalem on my holy mountain. You see, what God is doing, he's talking about the greater David because he's alluding back into Scripture. And we're going to look at that in a moment. But it's the greater David who died to satisfy the penalty of our sinful hearts. David was the king who wrote perhaps the psalm, but it was certainly speaking about him. But it's Christ who would die for our hearts. God is setting him up as the king. And we come to the part about God's rule. And let's look at verse 6 again. It says, for the Lord declares, I have placed my chosen king on a throne in Jerusalem on my holy mountain. The king proclaims the Lord's decree. The Lord said to me, you are my son. Today I have become your father. This was recorded in the Old Testament. This was recorded by David himself. You see, regarding Christ and his resurrection, Paul preached, and we bring to you the good news that what God promised to his fathers, that he has fulfilled to us, their children, by raising Jesus, also is written in the second psalm, you are my son, today I have begotten you. David would write, the Lord said to my Lord, I will put all your enemies under you. Hebrews said, for to which of the angels did God ever say, you are my son, today I have begotten you, or again, I will be to him a father and he shall be to me a son. Hebrews 1:5. God says we may have kings. And by the way, we look at our ruler in Washington. We look at him as the president of the United States. We've done this for how many presidents now since George Washington? We have rulers all throughout the world. We have kings and queens. We have presidents and prime ministers. And each and every one of them thinks that they are the ruler of their nation. And in a sense, they are. But in a bigger sense, they're not. Because you see, our God is sovereign. Our God is Lord. And he sets rulers up and he takes rulers down. Because the ruler is Jesus Christ. In verse 8, he says, only ask and I will give you the nations as your inheritance, the whole earth as your possession. You see, this world and all that is of it really ultimately belongs to God. It belongs to Christ. That's why we as Christians are called to be good stewards of it, because we are his hands and feet. And people mock us and say that many times we're not good stewards of the environment. Sometimes we're not, but we ought to be. It's just that is not Mother Earth. That is God's domain. And I am his child. In Isaiah 9, 6 through 7, Don told me, hey, you can't talk about this. It's not Christmas yet. Well, I am. He says, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be on his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there shall be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. And this, of course, is speaking of Jesus. Now, most of us understand that there really is no peace in this world right now. And we get that. And that's because our God is not here on earth ruling. Where he does rule is in the hearts of his children. And so in the hearts of his children, we are to be the examples. We are to be the models of who our Christ is. When the world looks at us, they ought to see Jesus Christ. But you know what this has gotten us many times? Put in dungeons. Beheaded. Cast in the lion's dens. Burned alive. Do you know when persecution happens within a country, there are two peoples, two groups that have been consistently targeted throughout history? They are Jews and they are Christians. Jews because they're people of the book, and Christians because we belong to Christ. But at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow on heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. You know, we may not be happy with the Supreme Court. We may not be happy with our governor. We may not be happy with our president. We may not be happy with our Congress. We may not be happy with whatever. But someday, every single one of them, like everyone throughout history, is going to stand before the Lord. And if they don't know him, it's not going to be good, because every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess him as Lord. My prayer is that we do it before it gets bad, before it has an eternal judgment. But then verse 9 says, you will break them with an iron rod and smash them like clay pots. This is talking about God. And here I want you to think about the revelation. In Revelation chapter 19, beginning of verse 11, it says, then I saw heaven open, and a white horse was standing there. Its rider was named Faithful and True, for he judges fairly and wages a righteous war. In other words, the one who's coming, people are going to get what they deserve. And it's not going to be based on our system of fairness. It's going to be based on the righteous knowledge of a holy God who knows every heart. His eyes were like flames of fire, and on his head were many crowns. A name was written on him that no one understood except himself. He wore a robe dipped in blood, and his title was the Word of God. The armies of heaven, dressed in the finest of pure white linen, followed him on white horses. From his mouth came a sharp sword to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron rod. He will release the fierce wrath of God, the Almighty, like juice flowing from a wine press. On his robe at his thigh was written his title, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You know, I am so sick and tired of people talking about this lovey-dovey, you know, peacenik, hippie, I don't know what you want to call him, kind of Jesus. This milquetoast kind of character. And yes, he loves us. Yes, he calls us friend. But he is the Lord of lords and he is the King of kings. And one day he's going to set right what is wrong. Amen. And there aren't going to be any prisoners. There's not going to be any middle ground. Which leads us to man's responsibility. You know, when we talk about the sovereignty of God, there are some very foolish people, I think, that believe the man has no responsibility whatsoever because God's got it all. Well, no, that is simply not true because man does have a responsibility. You know, speaking of the revelation, we see judgment after judgment upon rebellious, sinful man. But we also see all through the pages of the revelation, God offering salvation. After judgment, judgment, judgment. God says, all who will come, I will embrace. I will give life. But you see, the wrath of God is also in the context of his mercy. You know, one of the scariest passages in the Bible for me, and it was something I read once, it was in a book. It was kind of a novel about this time, but it made me stop and think. In Revelation, there's an account where there's coming one of the judgments is where people will only have blood to drink. I want you to picture that for a moment. You're not going to have a Coca-Cola. Not going to have a glass of milk. You're not even going to have water. Everything that comes out of a tap, everything comes out of a fountain is going to be blood. Why? Because God says, you're going to pay for the blood of my martyrs that has been spilled. And I got to tell you something, that doesn't gross you out. I don't know what will. I mean, that ought to scare the living fire out of people. But man has a responsibility. In verse 10, it says, now then, you kings, act wisely. Be warned, you rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with reverent fear and rejoice with trembling. You know what God is telling the kings of this earth, the leaders of this earth? You ought to worship the way my people are to worship. Because this is how we're to worship. Serve the Lord and to do it out of reverent fear and to rejoice with trembling. Because our God is in control. James 4:7 says, submit yourselves then to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Now the New King James reads in the next verse, verse 12, says, kiss the Son. Kiss the Son. What an incredible picture. But we miss it because I think the way it's translated in other passages, for example, the New Living Translation helps us understand what this means. It says, submit to God's royal Son or what? Or he will be angry. And you will be destroyed in the midst of all of your activities. For his anger flares up in an instant. Again, history has shown us. The wicked can do well for a season. But sometimes their calamity comes pretty quickly. In a moment, all that they have accomplished is turned around. How sad. Jesus said, we ought to pray, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, because that ought to be our heartbeat. That ought to be our heart's desire. Not that our will be done, not that our kingdom would come to pass, but that God's kingdom would come to pass and that we're a part of it. You know, I grew up in the height of the Cold War. I don't know, maybe some of you, you're old enough, Jim, I know you've been there. I remember growing up and we had A-bomb drills. We had to climb under the desk. Like somehow that was supposed to what, save us? Like really? You know, it was weird. I mean, I lived through the Cuban Missile Crisis when we came as close to nuclear war with the Soviets as we ever had. I grew up in a time of often violent protests and riots. I, I was growing up in the midst of the civil rights movement, and I was growing up when there were massive protests, often violent, you know, over the Vietnam War. I remember well, you know, the Kent State shootings. I actually lived in Ohio at that time, and you know, I remember so much of this. But I confess that in my 61 years of life, I have never witnessed anything quite as extreme, quite as unsettling, quite as ugly and disrespectful as I have been watching in our news in the past year or so. There's a part of me that cringes, there's a part of me that's becoming incredibly pessimistic about the future of our world. But I do remember this. God's word, Jesus actually said, don't let anyone mislead you. For many will come in my name claiming I am the Messiah. And by the way, what presidential race have we not essentially heard that? You know, they're going to deliver us. They're going to make everything awesome. How? Well, they will deceive many, and you will hear of wars and threats of wars, but don't panic. Well, yeah, we have wars and rumors. We have this whacked out Korean guy that wants to shoot missiles. I mean, we have terrorists that want to bring bombs into our country. Some of them horrific. But don't panic. Yes, these things must take place, but the end will not follow immediately. Nation will go to war against nation and kingdom against kingdom, which has been happening down through time. There will be famines and earthquakes in many parts of the world, but all this is only the first of the birth pains, and more will come. Then you will be arrested, persecuted, and killed. You will be hated all over the world because you are my followers. Boy, is this happening or what? You know, people being lined up on a beach to be beheaded because they name the name of Christ. Many will turn away from me and betray and hate each other. And many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. I could name church after church, denomination after denomination that's doing just that. They name the name of Christ, but they're anything but. Sin will be rampant everywhere, and the love of many will grow cold. And as I read that, all you have to do is look at a newspaper or watch a news show to see the reality of that taking place. You know, I'm reading this, and I don't mean to be Donnie Downer. This is a messianic psalm, and I realize that it could be pretty dark. It's got a lot of warnings in it. And you know, if we were to look at this, we could go, man, oh man, you know, like what hope do we have? What hope does my unsaved friends and my neighbors have? Well, I will share with you, the hope is you. The hope is you. The hope is us. But you know what's fascinating? I didn't finish our psalm. Because, you know, as God has been giving us warnings and God has been talking about laughing at those that, you know, that hate him, he says these words at the end. Blessed are all those who put their trust in him. Blessed are all of you and me who put our trust in God. In Matthew, Jesus put it this way. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. And the good news about the kingdom will be preached throughout the whole world so that all nations will hear it. And then the end will come. The part I love about this, and if I really can encourage you in this, I know that our world really looks messed up. And in truth, it really, really is. But don't look through the eyes of the world. Look through the eyes of Christ. Our God really does have this. As insane as our world seems to be, as messed up as it seems to be getting, our God is in control. He knows you. He's got your address. He hears your prayers. And if you trust Him, He will still your heart and give you hope. That's my hope. Because I'm going to tell you, I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, but I know who's got tomorrow. And His name is God. So, though there's a lot to be concerned about, we have even more to be thankful for and so much more to hope in. His name is Jesus Christ. Do you know Him? Let's pray. Our dear and Heavenly Father God, sometimes we read Your Word and we go, oh man, what is going on? And sometimes we read Your Word and we see it lived out in the world around us. And the reason for that is Your Word is living. It is powerful. It isn't just the Word that was written in antiquity. It's a Word that speaks to today, this very day. Remember the words of Solomon when he said, there's nothing new under the sun. We just change the label. We change the box. We package it different. But evil has always been evil. Sin has always been sin. And people have always been rebellious. But Lord, if we are to have hope in this world, we need to know You. We need to know You and have a relationship with You. For You, God, demonstrated Your love toward us, and while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And though the wages of sin is death, the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And so we want to live. We want an abundant life. But the abundant life is best defined as what You live through us. And so my prayer is, if there is one here that does not know You as Savior and Lord, you may think you've got hope, but you don't. Not really. What are you hoping in? Because our world isn't getting better. It's just getting crazier. Our hope is in You, the unchangeable God of the universe. And Lord, I want to open up the pages of Your Word and show people how they can have a relationship. Lord, it begins with a decision that says, here am I. I want to know You, Lord. And we can help them with that. And for the rest of us, just help us to change our hearts and our attitudes. Let us not become fearful of the world around us, but dig deeper into Your Word and trust You more and more. You've got this. You always have. You always will. And we truly, God, are safe in Your hands. Blessed are those who trust in the Lord. I do. And I pray we all do. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, there is no closing music. So we're going to end here. Thank you all. But, you know, if God has stirred in your heart and you want to know more about this Jesus I talked about, come talk to us. Come talk to me. We'll be happy to help. God bless you all. Have a wonderful week.